بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're feeling good today, mashallah, huh? Very loud and very enthusiastic. Well, the chapter that we're dealing with today is a very dangerous one. It's called the chapter of Al-Li'an, which is cursing. And this happens when a man finds that his wife is cheating on him. And he would like to separate from her, but he doesn't know how to do that. As we know, if a man says or accuses any woman of fornicating or committing the act of adultery, is his word acceptable? He has to provide four witnesses. Now, this is not the case when the husband is the one who is accusing his wife. So if he finds his wife with another man, do you think that he would say, please wait, I'll just get three witnesses and come? This is not applicable. And if this is not applicable, what can he do? This is an issue that is related to his honor. This is an issue that would affect his offspring, because this is not his child. So what is to be done? This is what we will learn, inshallah, in this chapter. Hadith number 324, hadith of Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him. And then who will read this for us? Okay, the brother there.
Abdullah bin Umar reported, a person said, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if a person finds his wife committing adultery, what does he do? If he speaks out, he has spoken something that is serious, and if he doesn't speak out, he would be covering something like that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not answer him. Later on, the man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, what I had asked you about, I am being tested by it now. Allah then revealed these verses in Surah An-Nur, those who curse their wives. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then recited these verses to the man, advised him and reminded him and told him that the punishment in this life is far lesser the torment of the hereafter. The man said, by the one who sent you to us as a prophet, I didn't say a lie against her. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then called the woman and advised her and told her that the punishment in this life is far lesser than the torment of the hereafter. She said, by the one who has sent you with the truth, he is a liar. The man began and swore four times in the name of Allah and that he was one of the truthful, and then invoked curse for the fifth time and saying, let there be curse of Allah upon him if he were among the liars. Then it was her turn. She testified it four times by Allah that he was lying, and the fifth was that Allah's anger would be upon her if he was telling the truth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then separated them. He added, Allah knows that one of you is lying. Is any one of you willing to repent? He repeated it three times.
And there's another narration.
In another narration, he told the man, you have nothing against her. He said, O Prophet of Allah, what about my money? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you have no money with her. If you were telling the truth, the dowry is for what you had enjoyed her with. But if you were lying, this is ever further from you to get anything.
Very well. Now, this hadith is about a man coming to the Prophet ﷺ and inquiring about a hypothetical issue. What would a husband do if he comes and finds his wife cheating on him? And the Prophet ﷺ did not reply to that, because at the time did not have knowledge of it. If the man who was faced with that situation, if he were to speak without any witnesses, this is a serious issue. He will be flogged. And if he does not speak and covers it, this is even worse, because maybe the woman would conceive someone who's not his. So the Prophet did not answer him. Sometime later, the man came again to the Prophet, but sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the hypothetical issue is not hypothetical anymore. He said, O Prophet of Allah, what I asked you about last time, by Allah, this happened to me. Now I'm tested with it. So Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the verses of the Quran and the verses of Surah An-Nur in the very beginning were revealed, so the ruling was known. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke and addressed to the man, listen, don't be impulsive. Don't let your anger blind you. Fear Allah. Prophet kept on advising him and reminding him of Allah. And the man said, after the Prophet told him that the torment of the hereafter is nothing compared to the punishment in this life, he said, by Allah who had sent you to us with the truth, I did not lie upon that woman. So the Prophet called the other party, because him swearing is not enough, and the judge has to listen to both parties, otherwise he would not be fair. And he reminded her of Allah, and he told her the same thing, and he told her that the torment of the hereafter is far greater than the punishment of this life. She said, by Allah who sent you with the truth, he is a liar. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told the man to testify by Allah. So it's not enough to swear and say, by Allah, she is an adulterer. He has to say, by Allah, I testify that I am telling the truth. I testify that I am telling the truth by Allah 4 times. And the 5th time, he would say, by Allah, I testify that I'm telling the truth and that she had committed adultery. The 5th time, he would say, and the curse of Allah would befall upon me if I was lying. And then the Prophet ﷺ would call the woman and to say the same. Of course, it goes to be the sunnah that after he testified 4 times by Allah that she has committed adultery and I'm not lying, the 5th time, the sunnah is for the imam to put his hand over the mouth of the person and remind him 3 times that if you say it, it will take effect. If you say that Allah's curse on me, Allah will curse you. So be careful, don't go ahead, as a warning. And likewise, she would say, I testify by Allah that he is a liar. And the 5th time, again, he would give her a reminder and remind her of Allah and threaten her of Allah's torment. And she would say that he is a liar and may the wrath and anger of Allah be upon me if he was telling the truth. The man, he says, may Allah's curse. And here she says, may Allah's wrath and anger, which is far greater. Why? Because the sin of a woman is greater than the sin of a man. The man's sin was slandering. So he can be flogged for that, and that is it. But her sin is far serious, because if she's lying, she will be conceiving someone that does not belong to the man. And also, his sisters, his daughters, his mother will all become mahram to someone who's not a mahram to them. And when he dies, he will inherit, and he is not supposed to inherit. So all of these things make her sin far greater and more serious than his, and that is why the wrath and anger of Allah is upon her. So when she did this, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam ordered them to separate. And in the case of li'an, in the case of cursing due to accusation between the spouses, no way until the day of judgment they can reconcile. This is what the scholars say. So, khalas, they're separated. After 2 years, the man says, wallah, I miss my ex-wife. I'd like to marry her again. This is not acceptable. Why? Because their situation and the level it reached, the cursing in public and also going to court, this means that it is over between them. Some scholars say, if the man after 2 years says, listen, I was wrong, I didn't see her, but I just accused her falsely, then he would be flogged 80 lashes for what he had said about her. And then they may reconcile. Some scholars say that they may, because he confessed and he was punished for that. But the majority say it is a no-go. Reaching such a level in marriage cannot be going back. The man complained and said, O Prophet of Allah, what about my dowry? Now you've separated us. What about my dowry? And the Prophet told him, alayhi salatu wasalam, there is no dowry for you. Because if you were lying, definitely you don't deserve a thing. But if you're telling the truth, then the dowry you had given her is in compensation for the times you had enjoyed her and spent time with her. So this is almost what is in the hadith. Following hadith goes in the same lines, 325. Okay, the brother, please read it.
Narrated Ibn Umar, a man accused his wife with adultery and refused to have any relations to her son. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the man and his wife to carry out liyan, cursing one another, as Allah has ordered. He then ruled the boy to his mother and separated between the man and his wife.
Okay, this is similar, is it not? There is a difference, however. In this case, there is a boy involved. In the first hadith, he just accused her. In this hadith, the woman has a child, and he says that this child is not mine. And this is one of the reasons for li'an. This is one of the reasons of having the cursing procedure. One, if a man accuses his wife of adultery, and not just because someone told him, this is not enough. It is because he had seen that with his own two eyes, but he failed to bring witnesses. So he refers to what? Al-li'an. The second condition is, or reason, is when a man has a child from his wife and he says that the child is not mine. And this can happen for many reasons, but the easiest among them is if the man himself is impotent. If a woman marries a man in the East and he's in the West, they don't see each other, they have the marriage contract, and they get married through Skype or through any means, and the marriage is correct. And after 6 months, she gives birth. And she says, Mashallah, you have a child. I have a child. I haven't met you. What are you, crazy woman? We've never met. She says, yes, but we're married. This is your child. What can be done in this case? This is what we'll find after the break. So stay tuned.
If I were to ask you about the life of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the incidents that occurred before his prophethood and in Mecca and in Medina, about the names of his loved ones and his wives and his children, how much would we be able to know? How many incidents have we memorized? Brothers and sisters, isn't it more important that we study the seerah of the most important human being who ever walked the face of this earth? Join me, your host Yasir Qadhi, as we discuss the most important biography of the most illustrious human being that ever lived, the seerah of our beloved Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Join Yasir Qadhi in Seerah of the Prophet, peace be upon him, every Monday at 4:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 2 a.m. UK on Peace TV. Dialogue. Dialogue. Discussion. 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 Debate. 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 Rebuttal. 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 Conclusion. Conclusion.
Eliminate misconceptions about religion. Get enlightened.
Witness Dr. Zakir Naik in a battle of words in Crossfire. Tomorrow at 8:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 10 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
The Book of Allah is the foundation of Islamic civilization and the way out of every trial. Every generation of Muslims needs to develop a relationship with the Quran. So join me, Riyaz Ansari, for reflections on the Quran.
Explore how the Quran has a wondrous impact on those who receive it as a book of guidance in Reflections on the Quran with Riaz Ansari, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. So, what would a man do in such a scenario? He is living in the United States and she is living in XYZ country, and she has delivered a child after having the marriage contract, but the man did not touch her. So, is this a miracle? Did he say, oh, mashallah, tabarakallah, this is pregnancy through good intention? No, it's not his child. She says, yes, he is. What to do? This is the case. He would go to the Muslim court or to the Muslim judge and deny being the parent of that child. And if the woman presents the marriage contract, he swears, I testify by Allah that this is not my child. Four times, and the fifth, that may Allah curse me if this child is mine. And to protect herself from being punished, because if the woman says to the judge who tells her, now it's your time to testify and swear, she said, I'm not going to. Then he's not his child. No, it is his child, but I'm not going to swear. What does the judge do? This is obvious. If she's not willing to testify and swear, this means that she has given birth out of wedlock to that child, and it's not the man's child. So to prevent herself, to save herself from the prescribed punishment in this life, she has to swear. And if she's lying, then the punishment would be in the hereafter. So she swear, as in the hadith, and then the judge separates them. Okay, what about the child? The child cannot be attributed to the man. Then who would he be called after? He would be called after his grandfather from his mother's side. So he would take the name of the mother's family, because he does not have a father or a family to be called after when his actual father void and waived his right because he does not claim him. And this is a serious issue, and people should not go into that unless there is ample proof. Doubts are not sufficient. People would doubt and say that this is not my child. Why? He says, I'm white and he's black. Or I'm black and my child is white. And this is not enough reason to accept that. And the following hadith illustrates this quite well. But before going to it, do we have any questions? So we'll open the floor for questions.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Assalam.
My question is related to the witnesses of zina taking place. So today, mashallah, the technology has advanced. So almost everyone has mobile phones with cameras, etc. So if they take a video, if they have proof with a video for this zina, so can they produce it in the court without the other three witnesses?
Islam is a religion for all times and places. In the Quran, Allah specifically stated that there has to be four witnesses. Therefore, any photography, any videotaping would not take place of even one single witness. Because nowadays we have editing, we have possibilities of manipulating it. Therefore, this has no effect at all in proving such a crime. Okay, we have, mashallah, too many.
Assalamu alaikum.
Salam.
My question is somehow related to the earlier question. Today, as we know, there are many medical tests we know where we can prove the parent of the child. So can we prevent our li'an and go through the medical test to identify the parent?
The brother is asking about referring to DNA, for example. And we can prove, so claim, that the child belongs to this person or to that person through DNA. So can we make this as a way of proving that the child is not his, or the child is his, even if he makes li'an? And the answer is no. Because DNA is in the hands of a number of people. And in some cases, maybe rarely, but happens that they make a mistake. They say that the print itself, it's a fingerprint, the DNA can never make mistakes, but it so happens it may be misinterpreted or misread, and there would come a time that a mistake may happen. In Islam, it does not rely on DNA. Maybe we can use it as a supporting evidence, but not the evidence. So if a man comes and said, this is not my son, and she says, wallah, he's your son, and we go to the judge, and the judge gives me or gives him and orders him to swear four times and testify that it is not his, the fifth Allah's curse upon him. And he does that, and she brings the medical proof that the DNA-wise, it's his son. Does the judge tell him, it is your son, you have to take him? No. This is only as a supporting evidence, but it has no effect in rejecting or refuting such a verdict. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum.
Salam.
Many times when children have fights with each other, they curse that may Allah's curse be on you. So is this allowed?
The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, لَيْسَ الْمُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّعَانِ وَلَا الطَّعَانِ وَلَا الْفَاحِشِ الْبَذِي, which translates to that a believer is not a one who curses or who slanders or who uses foul language. So it is not permissible at all to curse a Muslim. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, سِبَابُ الْمُؤْمِنِ فُسُوق, cursing and slandering and swearing at a believer is a great sin. And the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that those who curse a lot will not be among the witnesses on the Day of Judgment. And the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, do not use Allah's curse and do not curse others with Allah's fire or with Allah's anger. So this is totally prohibited.
Assalamualaikum.
Salam.
When a person commits adultery, he does it in secret. So it is difficult to bring four witnesses. So what should a person do?
This shows you what beautiful religion Islam is. It conceals faults and shortcomings. And that is why you cannot establish the prescribed punishment of flogging a fornicator unless you bring four witnesses, not only for witnesses seeing the room. They have to graphically describe the organs and the way and something that's too graphic. You have to see this. Four witnesses. Or if he confesses. And scholars say, since the beginning of Islam till today, not a single case was reported that four had seen this. Why? Because no one in his sanity would see people talking and, bring Ahmed and Abdullah. Let them, come on, quickly, let them see. And he's continuing doing what he's doing. He would stop. So this shows you how Islam protects privacy and gives another chance even to the greatest sinners to repent and ask for forgiveness.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
So why does a person curses himself when he's carrying out Qiyam if it is not permissible?
Why would a person curse himself
if he's carrying out Qiyam?
Why would a person curse himself if he's in the state of Qiyam? He's trying to prove his case. Now, if we say any husband who has any suspicion, go ahead and make Qiyam. Go to the judge and say, I testify she had fornicated or committed adultery four times. This is easy. This is lying. But when you say that the fifth time, may Allah's curse be upon me if I was lying, in this case, people would hesitate. So this is why he's instructed and ordered to make Qiyam, so that it would be the last barrier. Other than that, then he's definitely telling the truth.
When husband and wife curse each other, should they curse each other in public or only in front of the judge?
First of all, they do not curse each other. The husband curses himself if he was saying the false things, and she asks Allah's anger and wrath to be upon her if he was telling the truth. So they're not cursing each other, first of all. Second of all, this has to be public in the sense that the judge is going to judge them. Not that they are in their houses and they say, Wallahi, if talking to her, they know who's lying and who's telling the truth. But this has to be in front of a judge. No problem of it being in front of their families as well. But there has to be a judge to rule this thing for them. This is all the time we have. Until we meet next time, fi amanillah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.